started working together because he's done some, he and colleagues have done some very beautiful work on galactic cosmic rays and how they, right, there's this big interest in particle physics in many different aspects of galactic cosmic rays, not the least of which in recent years has been that there's been an anomaly in the higher energies than he's going to concentrate on today. So there's an anomaly in the production that some people wanted to interpret as perhaps the signature of dark matter annihilation in our galaxy and so on. So the work of Nir and his colleagues has given a lot of insight into why the early models on that were oversimplified. And in the course of telling about that, we learned from him all sorts of remarkable things about the spiral arms of the galaxy and how they are known to move relative to everything else. I'm hoping in the end that you find, okay, he gave us a little mini talk about it a few weeks ago. Anyhow, in the course of discussing all this with him, I learned that part of his sort of historical interest in cosmic rays got stimulated, and I don't know which is the order, maybe he'll reveal this, got interested in a possible connection between the cosmic ray flux and climate. And then that's led to a sort of independent interest in how cosmic rays may be modifying the climate and what the mechanism might be. So anyway, that's what he's going to be talking about. I gather from emails from some of the students that this is let's say a politically charged issue. I will vouch for him, he's a fantastic scientist, and so my view is that it would be odd for someone to be so good at normal things and some
design. The question is, does he get the money from the power plants?
I'd wish.
Anyhow, in that spirit, he's open to being question answering questions, and we will as to our heart's delight, I hope we may run out of time, but then we'll continue over the reception, and you're probably willing to come back. He's spending the year in the Institute for Advanced Study on sabbatical. Next week, as it happens, by chance, we have another talk, although not in the colloquium, it's in the Science in the Square series on Wednesday afternoon by Frank Hsu, who's also going to talk about climate, totally different perspective. And you should definitely come to that. It's
going to
be a great talk also. Thank you.
Okay, thanks for the introduction and thanks for inviting. It's always a pleasure coming to NYU because it means coming to NYC. Okay, what I'm going to talk about is, as Dennis introduced, I'm going to talk about the effects of cosmic rays on the climate. And I'm going to start by showing you that the sun has a large effect on the climate. And then I'll try to convince you that this very remarkable link is due to some effects that the cosmic rays appear to have on the climate. Cosmic rays are modulated by solar activity, so if cosmic rays affect the climate, so will the sun. So I'll show you the empirical evidence, and which includes experiments from a lab, or two labs actually, and I'll show you empirical evidence from climatic data, and I'm going to describe you what we're doing now, just a little bit, and then we're going to get to the politically charged part, and that's how it pertains to our understanding of the 20th century climate change and what it means for the 21st century climate change. The sun is an active star. It means that things are not constant. The solar constant is not constant. It changes by about a tenth of a percent between solar minimum and solar maximum, and also secularly on long time scales. But in addition to changes in the solar irradiance, the solar constant, there are also changes in other components of the sun, such as changes in the amount of UV it emits, in the amount of X-rays, in the strength of the solar wind, in the number of sunspots, and so forth. And all those things have three major timescales. One is the 11-year solar cycle, which is associated with the fact that every 11 years or so, the sun switches magnetic polarity, and the short timescale associated with the eruptions, such as the magnetic field reconnection on the sun.
And short?
Days, hours and days. And then you have long time variations, which are on timescales of decades and centuries, which is a long-term modulation of the solar cycle. And that happens because the top part of the sun is convective. The 40% in radius of the sun is convective, and the convection is has erratic behavior, and therefore this long-term variability cannot be predicted. Okay. These variations in solar activity affect the climate, this is probably one of the nicest examples showing that. In the top, we see the ratio between carbon-14 and carbon-12 and 13 as reconstructed from tree rings. Basically, we can measure the amount of carbon-14 in a given tree ring. We know when that ring was formed, in what year, and therefore we can measure what was the production rate of carbon-14 in the atmosphere. Carbon-14 is formed by spallation by cosmic rays. And on those short timescales, it's modulated by the sun. So measuring the carbon-14 in the tree rings basically tells us what was the solar activity at that time. At the bottom, we see the ratio between oxygen 18 to oxygen 16 in this case in stalagmites in a cave in Oman in the southern Arabian Peninsula. And that is a climate indicator because water with oxygen 18 is heavier than water with oxygen 16. So we get various fractionation effects. For example, the evaporation rate from the oceans depends on the isotope, and it depends on the temperature, and so forth. So basically, this depends on the temperature, in this case, of primarily the temperature in the Indian Ocean. So you see here a correlation between solar activity and the temperature of the Indian Ocean on a time scale of thousands of years.
Does it also agree with just the concentration?
What?
Does this graph agree with the concentration of CO2?
Oh, over this time scale, there was almost no variation in the CO2. It was basically 280 ppm on this time scale. Which line passes down here?
A couple of them.
Okay.
Green.
What?
Green.
Okay. Just to note. This is another example. In this case, it's the northern Atlantic. You see here again the carbon-14, it's reconstructed with tree rings, but in black you have some kind of a climatic record, which is, in this case, it's sedimentation from the ocean core. What happens is that under colder climates, you get ice from the Arctic float further south. And when these icebergs melt, they leave the ice rafted debris, the dust that they collect, to settle further south in the Atlantic. So if you see more ice rafted debris at some mid latitude in the Atlantic, you can basically know how cold the northern Atlantic was, whether you had more icebergs or less. And again, you see a very nice correlation between the climate in the northern Arctic and solar activity. Okay, so the sun has a large effect on the climate.
So what are the air pores on this?
What?
What are the air pores on this?
It's not physics, so there are no air bars.
What was that? What were you supposed to conclude from the previous graph? The previous one. No. Back. Am I supposed to say, oh yeah, it's correlated?
Yes.
Right. I mean, you can quantify that.
Yes, you can say that there's a correlation coefficient of whatever. It's very high here. You see it by eye. You don't need statistics to convince, right?
If you're a skeptic, you'd be very happy to see the correlation coefficient and an error on it.
It doesn't matter. You can go to the paper. This is in Nature or Science. It is really a measure of the cosmic rays reaching the Earth. It is believed that on this time scale, it's mostly due to variation in the solar activity.
So how much does slight pressure variations in the atmosphere and so on affect the cosmic ray flux reaching Earth?
They do affect, and you have to take it into account. But people know how to measure the pressure with the barometers, and they correct it.
Okay.
Yeah. But in this case you don't care because carbon-14 is measured at the top of the atmosphere and it mixes and it takes 2 years to mix it in the atmosphere and then about 40 years until it's absorbed in the oceans. It is average over a long time.
So it's not just the surface thing?
Yeah. There was a question at the back, sorry.
Yeah, I see that most of the major peaks and except for the top right part, there's a major peak in the above graph which coincides with the major drop in the lower.
I never said the sun is the only thing that affects the climate. There are other things that affect the climate, plus there are internal variations in the climate. And therefore, you don't expect there ever to be a correlation coefficient of 1.00000, right? So the question is whether there is a. Yeah, there should be. It would be naive not to expect there to be. Okay. If we look at shorter timescales, in fact, the first person to think that solar variability might affect the climate was Sir William Herschel. He didn't have a very good temperature record, so what he did was to look at the a price of wheat in the London Wheat Exchange under the assumption that climate will affect the crop yield, that will affect the price of wheat, and therefore have a climate record. So he correlated that with a sunspot number, and in some very hard to follow manuscript, he says that there is a correlation. Don't ask me what the correlation coefficient is. 200 years later, Eddie showed that if you look at the past, and he was basically the first person in modern times to work on this, on the idea that the sun might have an effect on the climate. And he noted that if you look at the climate in Northern Europe, then it correlates with solar activity, as you can reconstruct with the sunspot number since about 1600, or with other indicators such as the number of auroras or the amount of carbon-14 formed in the atmosphere. He noted, for example, that during the height of the Maunder minimum, when there were almost no sunspot measured on the sun, that Maunder minimum coincided with a little ice age when it was particularly cold in Europe. Or on the other hand, that during the Middle Ages, when the sun was more active, it was also warmer in Europe. And in fact, we know today that these are global events. Okay, so we see on long time scales correlations with solar activity. What about the 11-year solar cycle? It turns out that over the 11-year solar cycle, it's hard to see temperature variations. And the reason it's hard to see temperature variations is because Earth has a large heat capacity with the ocean. So even if you pump in or pump out a lot of heat, you don't see a lot of temperature change. But it turns out you can see those temperature changes, and I'll show you in a second. But you can also measure directly, or almost directly, the amount of heat that you have in the oceans. What you see here is the rates of change of the sea level over the past, say, 80 years. And on short timescales, most of the sea level change is because of thermal expansion. So what you're seeing here is the heat going into the oceans during solar maxima. You see heat going into the oceans. And during solar minima, you see heat leaving the oceans. So you can quantify the effect that the sun has on Earth's energy budget. And this effect is about 6 or 7 times larger than just the variations in the solar irradiance. What does it mean? It means that there is some other mechanism which is responsible for linking between solar activity and climate, and it's large, and it has to be taken into account. I don't know what's the correlation for coefficient here, but it's high.
Which curve is based
on this graph? Does it really matter? No, just kidding. The red is the sun, and the black is the sea level, and the error bars for the sea level, because that's I did it, so I added the error bars, are in, it's hard to see, but they are in the hatched regions that you see here. You see here hatched regions? So that's the error bar for the sea level. And the solar activity I didn't reconstruct, so didn't have error bars, sorry. Yes?
The scale for the solar is the solar constant, the irradiance.
Okay, it's not the solar radiance was only measured in the last since say 1980. Before that, it's a reconstruction of what the solar irradiance should have been based on other proxies such as measurements of the magnetic field or the sunspot number and things like that.
Okay, so for the left half of this graph, it's really sunspots.
Yeah. But it doesn't really matter. I mean, everything changes here with 11-year solar cycle. And
I think you're going to show later that the right thing, the correct, the most useful thing to plot on the right-hand scale would be the cosmic ray flux.
Yes, but we don't have measurements of the cosmic ray flux before 1940.
Right.
Yeah. So you need something which is relatively homogeneous on this time scale. Okay. This was published a few years ago with data until about 2000. If it's correct, then it should continue, and in fact it does. You can measure the sea level, here you see it in points, using satellite altimetry data, and you can ask the question, could this be explained by the solar cycle? And in fact, you get a very nice fit between the sea level minus a linear trend which was removed. And this level can be explained with the sun and with the El Nino Southern Oscillation. Okay, that explains more than 70% of the variance. Just those two things.
The data points are the
satellite altimetry data minus a linear trend.
Right, and then the gray solid curve?
The solid curve is the fit, and that's a model that includes just the solar cycle plus El Nino.
Which way does the linear term that you subtracted go, and how big is it?
It goes up, because sea levels are rising, because there was global warming over the 20th century.
So that's not displayed unless I subtract it out.
Oh yeah, because I'm not interested in that physics. I mean, I'm interested, but not here. Okay, you can actually, it's very hard to see the temperature variations associated with it because of the large heat capacity, but you can ask the... what did I do? We didn't move enough. Okay, what you can do is fold the temperature data over the 11-year solar cycle. And what you get is that
halfway
is excellent, exactly. You can get the average global temperature folded over the solar cycle, and you can see a small variation of about 0.1 degree over the solar cycle. This is a small variation, it's not very large, but if you multiply it by the amount of heat that you have in the mixed layer in the oceans, or the heat capacity that you have there, you find that it's consistent with the 1 watt per square meters that you get from the ocean sea level. Now, 0.1 degree is very small compared to the year-to-year variations that we anyway have in the climate, which is why it is hard to see the 11-year solar cycle in the climate data, but it's there. Okay.
The last one, I'm sorry, I have to realize, you know, I don't understand what you did with, how you included the effect of ENSO, the previous one.
Here?
No, the previous one.
Yes.
Can you explain what you mean by including
It's a model that includes the sun.
What model? What model do you mean?
What?
I mean, can you just explain the plot again?
Yes. You assume that the sea level, is depends on the solar cycle.
The globally average sea level
is depends on the flux, which is proportional to the solar cycle, plus an integral, a term which is the integral of it, because you can have additional terms associated with changing in glaciations, for example. And then assume that the and there's another term which is proportional to the El Nino Southern Oscillation Index and integrals of that. And it turns out that those effects, those additional terms, are negligible. So it's the the sea level is primarily proportional to the rate of the heat going into it and the El Nino Southern Oscillation Index. Okay, El Nino is an oscillation in the Pacific Basin, which what it does, it mixes water with different temperatures. It includes a lot of things, but what it really does is mix water with different temperatures.
That happens on a 2 to 7 year time scale.
Yes. 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 I agree with every word that you say. The fact is that there is a statistically significant correlation between the sea level and El Nino index. And it's the index itself and not an integral of the index, which you can explain by the fact that during the El Nino oscillation, you mix water with different, it's not putting heat into the oceans, but you take two water elements that have different temperatures and mix between them. And because the expansion coefficient of the oceans is not, of water, is not constant with temperature, you will get an expansion because of it, and that's why the correlation is with the index itself and not an integral of it. But that's not part of the talk. Okay, because of all the variance in the detrended sea level, 70% of it is explained by those two things. About 25% is the El Nino, and the rest, which is 45%, is the sun. Okay, another thing which appears to change with the solar cycle is the low altitude cloud cover, which you see here. If you look at it, you see here the cosmic ray flux reaching Earth, and or measured on Earth. And in blue, you see the change in the low altitude cloud cover. There are some arguments about this plot because there's a problem. In 1994, there was a problem with a satellite, continuity of the satellite data. But if you want to know, then ask me at the end what the problems were.
Yeah, how is the low cloud amount in percent determined?
It's measured with satellites.
You just average over the whole year for what fraction of
it's the average, it's probably yearly or monthly averages. Of the total amount, which is measured with satellites, looking at the albedo or something.
Okay,
so you can use the tide gauges or the solar or the satellite altimetry. You can use other data sets to estimate what is the peak-to-peak variation in the energy budget associated with the solar cycle. And translate that into a change in radiative forcing. You can take another set of satellite data, the Earth Radiation Budget Experiment, and translate that change in cloud cover to a radiative forcing that you would expect on Earth because of the change in the cloud cover. So all those five. On average, we get every square meter facing the sun gets 1,360 watts per square meter. If we average it over the 4 pi r squared of the surface of the Earth, we have to divide it by 4 because that's the ratio between the a cross-section facing the sun and the total surface area. So we take 1360 divided by 4 and then multiply it by 1 minus the albedo because the albedo times that is immediately reflected back to space. So that number that you get is the energy budget that Earth has, basically. How many watts arrive at each square meter on Earth? Now, what people do in climate science is to quantify various effects as if there is a change in this flux coming to Earth. It's not exactly correct because what greenhouses do, they block or they reduce the emissivity of radiation going back to space. But what? Doubling the amount of CO2 is equivalent to reducing the emissivity back to space, the emission, sorry, back to space by 3.8 watts per square meter for the same given state. So it is as if the flux that we got from the sun decreased by 3.8 watts per square meter. So this change is called the radiative forcing. Okay, so if you take this change in the energy budget associated with a cloud cover, you get again something like 1 watt per square meter. On the other hand, if you look at the changes in the solar irradiance, in the solar constant, and translate that into changes in radiative forcing, you see that it's significantly smaller than the changes in the energy budget associated with what you measure from the sea surface temperature, from the tide gauges, from the altimetry data, from the cloud cover, and so forth. So it means that we should have some kind of mechanism which amplifies it. Something which is sensitive to one of the non-thermal components coming from the sun. Now, the mechanism that I think takes place, and I'll show you exactly the evidence for it in what follows, is the following. It is through a modulation of the ionization that Earth has due to cosmic rays. Namely, when we looked before at the correlations between, say, solar activity and climate records by looking at a proxy, which is carbon-14 formed by cosmic rays, it's not only that it was a proxy for the solar activity, it was actually part of the mechanism of the linking between the sun and Earth. Okay, so cosmic rays are high energy particles coming from supernova remnants. Supernovae are massive stars that die, they explode, they accelerate their shells to large velocities, and then in the shock waves, you accelerate, yes, it's very strange. You accelerate particles to high energy up to about 10 to the 15 electron volts. The cosmic rays, which have an energy of about 10 GeV, are energetic enough such that when they hit the atmosphere at a typical height of about 10 kilometers, their secondaries can reach all the way down to the bottom of the troposphere, and these are the particles that govern the atmospheric ionization. Here, you have concrete, so we have a radon gas governing the ionization, but outside, it's cosmic rays. These ions, we now, okay, so on one hand, we know that the cosmic ray flux is modulated by the solar wind. When the sun is more active, it has a stronger solar wind, so the cosmic rays lose more energy as they propagate from the heliopause to where Earth is. They typically lose a GeV along the way. So they're modulated by solar activity. They dominate the ionization in the atmosphere, and now we know that they help nucleate small aerosols called the condensation nuclei. These are particles typically the size of, say, 3 nanometers. And we also know that these ions play a role in the growth of these small aerosols into larger aerosols. They need to grow to a size of typically 80 nanometers for them to be large enough such that when you reach 100% humidity, you condense and get clouds. Now, what will happen if you condense the same amount of water on more numerous cloud condensation nuclei, you will get more smaller droplets. So you will get a larger surface to volume ratio. This implies that you'll have more surface to reflect the sunlight. So you'll get clouds which are whiter, and therefore you will cool the Earth. You'll get other effects as well, like you will increase the lifetime of the clouds, but there are half a dozen different effects which are associated with a cloud, with a number density. Anyway, so the full link is the following. More active sun, stronger wind, less cosmic rays, less ionizations, less nucleation, less growth to large aerosols, less cloud condensation nuclei. So when we form clouds, the clouds are less white, we reflect less of the sunlight, and therefore we will heat the Earth. Okay?
How well understood is that cloud formation process? How confident can you be that more of these seeds make...
Okay, so now I'll show you some of the evidence. So I'll show you empirical evidence showing that cosmic rays affect the climate in general, and then I'll show you empirical evidence showing you each one of those steps.
But this picture, overall picture of cloud formation, is it something well established, or is it
your... No, it's not, it is established. I'll show you the evidence, but it's highly debated, especially because of the implications that it has. Okay, here some evidence. Sometimes the solar wind has a gust, and this gust causes a several-day reduction in the cosmic ray flux. You can see that in red. These gusts, or these reductions in the cosmic ray flux, are called Forbush decreases. And here you can see four different data sets. This is the number of aerosols over the oceans, and you can see a reduction in the number of aerosols. And you can see here three different independent cloud data sets showing you that following those reductions in the cosmic ray flux, you have a reduction in the cloud cover. Now, over these short timescales, you can distinguish between variations in the cosmic ray flux and other variations associated with solar activity. Because up front, we don't know whether it is the sun affecting the climate through cosmic rays, or maybe it is the sun affecting the climate through UV, which is absorbed in the stratosphere. Yes, everyone can agree about what the list is. The problem with the Forbush decreases is that you have a spectrum, a strength spectrum. If you try to, if you're greedy and you try to add too many Forbush decreases, you can show that because the strength decreases rapidly with the number index, if you add too many Forbush decreases, you add more noise than you're adding signal. Which is
how about examples where you don't see this
what?
Correlation, where you have a decrease in the...
In all the examples, when people try to attack it, in all the examples, I can show you that the level of noise that they have in their data set is larger than the signal that they expect to see. Why? Because they only look, for example, at the ISKIP data, which is not as good as MODIS. Why? Because they look in only some patch of the ocean over the Pacific, over the Pacific Ocean, and therefore they have more variance, and therefore the noise is higher. In all those cases, I can show you that the expected signal is below the noise that they have. So in all those cases that they don't see, it's because they placed an upper limit, which is not very relevant. Okay. This is the way I entered the field, because I realized that if the sun has an effect on the climate through cosmic rays, namely if cosmic rays, modulated cosmic rays, have an effect on the climate, then also intrinsic variations in the cosmic ray flux reaching the solar system, those two will have an effect on the climate. And the largest variations by far in the cosmic ray flux are due to the fact that our galactic vicinity is changing. Every so often, we pass through a spiral arm of the galaxy, and in spiral arms, okay, here you see an example of a two-armed spiral galaxy. the Milky Way is a four-armed galaxy, but the behavior would be the same. What happened is that the arms are patterns propagating at some speed. The stars themselves are moving, rotating at another speed, and therefore they pass through the spiral arms every so often. Now, because the spiral arms induce shocks in the interstellar medium, a lot of the star formation in the galaxy takes place in the spiral arms. And because supernovae occur in high mass stars that live a short life, most of the cosmic ray acceleration takes place not long after the spiral arm passages. Okay, so we would expect that every time we pass a spiral arm of the galaxy, we would witness a higher flux of cosmic rays.
What is this time scale?
145 million years.
145?
Yes.
Between?
Each consecutive spiral arm passages.
Spiral.
Yes. Okay. It so happens that there is a record from which we can reconstruct the cosmic ray flux, and that's iron meteorites. Iron meteorites integrate the flux of cosmic rays that they experience. So if you have many cosmic rays, you can reconstruct from it, if you have many iron meteorites, you can reconstruct from it the cosmic ray flux. So here you see a reconstruction of the cosmic ray flux and a reasonable range for it that you can get from iron meteorites. At the bottom, you see a reconstruction of the temperature, which is based on oxygen 18 to oxygen 16 isotope ratios in brachiopods, whatever they are. It basically tells us what the temperature of the tropical oceans were. And you can see that there is a correlation between the two. Namely, you can explain a large geological variations in the temperature based on the cosmic ray flux reaching the Earth. In fact, the iron meteorites can be used to reconstruct the cosmic ray flux up to about a billion years. And you can see that this periodicity, which manifests itself as clustering in the exposure ages of iron meteorites, it goes all the way back to about a billion years. And the temperature record on Earth based on oxygen 18 can be reconstructed only up to about 500 million years ago. Before that, we didn't have multicellular life forms, and therefore we cannot reconstruct the temperature this way, but we can reconstruct the temperature using a sedimentation record. So we can tell whether it was cold or hot. And the appearance of ice age epochs continues. We have ice age epochs every 150 million years or so, and in the right phase, from about a billion years ago. So basically, this explains the appearance of ice age epochs, or seven ice age epochs, in the past billion years.
What about when those meteors hit the Earth?
66 million years ago.
Yes. Do you see that also in this?
No, it's there was a comet or an asteroid that hit the Earth 66 million years ago, but it's not. It has nothing to do with these asteroids because they were roaming the solar system. They weren't. They're not associated with the KT event in this case. Okay. In addition to our passage through the spiral arms of the galaxy, there's another effect we can expect over geological timescales. Besides revolving around the galaxy, we are also moving up and down, and we cross the galactic plane every so often. How often? The astronomical data tells us that we just recently passed the galactic plane, moving northwards, and the period should be somewhere between 60 to 80 million years, implying that that's the full period, so the crossing should be every about half of that, so 30 to 40 million years. And again, we know the phase. What does the temperature record show us? This is the most extensive geochemical reconstruction of the temperature over the past 500 million years. Here you see about 20,000 geochemical measurements of oxygen 18. And you can see here again the 150 million year or so oscillation in the temperature, but superimposed on it, you see another oscillation. If you bin the data and average the different latitudinal data sets, this is what you get after you removed the long-term oscillation. And you can see here an oscillation in the temperature. Now, if cosmic rays affect the climate, then you would expect to get this kind of an oscillation, and you can try to model it. And when you model it, this is what you get. This is what the temperature should have been if the solar system moves up and down and the cosmic ray flux affects the climate.
Can I ask you something? When you make these fits, is the fit just the sum of these terms and then you're fitting the coefficients?
No, in this case it was solving for the motion of the solar system in the galactic potential. Because as you can see, I don't know if you can notice, but the fit is not, I mean, the period is not exact.
So if you solve the motion, then there's some coefficient.
Okay, so the assumption is that, so you solve for the solar system's motion, and then you assume that when you solve the diffusion of the cosmic rays from the galactic plane, you would expect there to be some kind of, the lowest order perturbation, sorry, the lowest order expansion would be a parabolic a density for the cosmic ray flux, and then you know how it's translated into temperature.
So you're computing those things, and that's what you apply, or you're fitting?
No, so this is fit. I don't know exactly how thick is the, or what is the what is the harmonic term in the second order term in the cosmic ray distribution. So assume that it is some value. And then, so there's an overall normalization in this direction.
So it's not clear to me how impressive that is, right? Because you've got a model that consists of a bunch of frequencies, and then you're fitting it to some data that has some different frequencies. I don't know if it's pretty.
Okay, so I can tell you that. You see a signal which has a periodicity of about 32 million years, which roughly is consistent with what you would expect. You see a phase which is to within 10%, which is roughly the error, what you would expect, because we know where we are relative to the galactic plane. We just crossed it a few million years ago, and we're moving northward, but it doesn't matter. So that fits as well. And in fact, there's a secondary oscillation on it, which also fits in astronomical data, and that you can see in this plot. What you see here is basically the same data, but now it's color-coded. This is cold and this is warm. And this is time. And this is time folded over 32 million years. And this part is a copy of this part, just so that it will be clearer. So you can clearly see a warm phase and a cold phase. But the best fit actually gives you a frequency, a secondary modulation in the form of a frequency modulation. And this frequency modulation is consistent in phase and in period with the radial epicyclic motion that the solar system is doing in the galactic in its galactic motion. When the sun is closer to the galactic center, the density is higher, so you oscillate faster. When the sun is further out, the density of the plane is lower, so you oscillate slower. And it's whether it is or not, I don't know, but this is a consistent picture that explains everything with the right phases and consistent periods.
And is that just one parameter, which is in effect the response to the...
I'm running out of time, yeah. Okay, so let me quickly show you a lab measurements. Here you see that when you increase the ionization, you increase the nucleation of small particles. This was an experiment that was run in Copenhagen. The experiment was redone in CERN. A few years later, they measured exactly the same thing.
The one in Copenhagen, where the ionization was caused by UV.
Yes.
The one in CERN was not.
No, it's not UV. The one that's in Copenhagen is cesium-137, so it's gamma rays. And the one at CERN, it's a pion beam, but I'm not sure.
Oh, okay.
But it doesn't matter because you form the ions, they don't care, the electrons don't care what formed them.
Well, if I had been right in interpreting your blog and it had been UV, then it would have mattered, but if it isn't UV, it doesn't matter.
No, it's not UV, it's cesium-137.
Okay, quite different.
Okay, this part was also measured. Here you see the spectrum of sizes of the particles when you just inject aerosols. So you see that they grow to become larger, but you have less and less of the larger ones. On the other hand, if you inject ions, again with cesium-137, what you get is that not only do you get more of the small ones, namely you increase the nucleation of small particles, but you also get more of the large ones because basically what happened is that you increase the availability of building blocks, which for these are sulfuric acid molecules, such that you could grow the larger particles. Now, if you change the cloud properties, you also change the reflectivity, and all you need to do to see that is to Google ship tracks, and you'll get these kind of pictures. Basically, what happens is that when a ship burns its dirty fuel, the exhaust particles serve as cloud condensation nuclei, and those clouds are much whiter. Okay, so everything in the link is there.
These sparks are done by ships.
What?
They're done by ship, by
chimneys. Yes, but the... Yes, I can show you. I have a colleague, Fang Chun-Yu, who is at the at SUNY Albany, and he does global aerosol models, and we can play with the mechanisms of the formation of the aerosols as we think they are changing, and simulate it, and then see how large of a radiative budget change we should expect, and it's. What?
There are a lot of aerosols, and a lot of condensation nuclei in the atmosphere, something like 10 to the 9 per cubic meter.
Well, it depends where. It depends where, because there are places in the oceans which are very clean, and there are places next to China which are very dirty. So there are places where you'll have a larger effect, and there are places that you have a smaller effect. And when we try to simulate it, we try to see what is the relative change in the number of aerosols and how would that translate into a change in cloud cover. But in principle, you could explain the 1 watt per square meter that you observe.
But, I mean, you said in principle you could compute the increase in the number of condensation nuclei. Can you do it? What's the increase in condensation nuclei that you produce?
I can show you a map, the result of the simulation, but after the talk. Okay, I won't tell you about the experiment that we are doing in order to pinpoint where the actual mechanism, sorry, what is the actual mechanism, because I'm running out of time, and in any case, I'm not going to tell you the final result anyway. So what does it mean for 20th century climate change? We can build a climate model and show that if you allow for the sun to have a large effect on climate, you can get a fit to the 20th century climate change, which is much better than what the global circulation models get if they exclude the real effect of the sun. You can integrate it forward in time to get estimates of what will happen, or realizations for what will happen over the 21st century. And this is what we get compared to the standard IPCC scenarios. Now, what it tells us is that basically, when we try to fit the 20th century, we are fitting the 20th century with a lower climate sensitivity, which is why our predictions for the temperature increase over the 21st century are going to be smaller as well. So then comes the question, how am I doing with time?
Oh, you're fine. Normally it ends at 5. It's 10 to 5.
Okay. We also started a bit late. And there were a lot of questions.
At least 10 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. We see that if you want to spend 20th century with the effect of the sun, then part of the warming should be attributed to the sun and parts due to humans. But because we have a larger net change in the radiative forcing, it implies that in order to get a consistent fit, we need a lower climate sensitivity. That's why the predictions for the future are smaller. And in fact, this is the low climate sensitivity is what you get empirically from the data.
There's some assumption about the human part in that last part.
Oh yeah, I took the, this is the vanilla flavored scenario that they have for business as usual. Sorry, this here. Oops, sorry. This is the vanilla flavored scenario.
What is that? I'm sorry. What is the vanilla flavored scenario?
It's not that we are going to
crash program.
Crash. We're not going to. It's business as usual without something extreme on either side. This is with the realizations of what the sun will do by looking at what the sun has did over the past 1,000 years and randomizing the phases to get some realizations. And also making similar realizations for volcanic activity and things like that.
Can you extrapolate that? CO2 records and temperature records can be extended back for
yes. Yeah, and then you get that you understand suddenly why there was the Maunder minimum and why there was the, like during the Maunder minimum, there was the Little Ice Age and the medieval warm period and so forth.
So say, if you look at the past 500,000 years.
On 500,000 years, you have larger climate variations associated with the Milankovitch cycles. So
CO2 doesn't count. No, I don't understand. I mean, you can run backward models in which CO2 is, say, the primary driver of change. And how do they compare with models where you have both CO2 and solar activity?
The model, okay, let me show you why the models give you, they don't do a good job. Okay, so first thing to note that recently there was a lack of warming. This is the temperature, in blue you see, for example, the ocean temperature. And it actually continued here like this over the past, say, 30 or so years from the first IPCC report. And in principle, the range of predictions that were made in the first IPCC report are the same as they are today. So we should have been within the range of predictions made by the IPCC, but instead we're now below the range of predictions. Why? One explanation could be that the climate sensitivity is on the low side and not on the high side. Another problem.
This is ocean temperature
and this is surface temperature. Another problem is that the heating observed in the past several decades is not consistent with what you would expect from just the CO2. And the reason is that the CO2, what it does, it blocks the atmosphere at in the infrared all the way up to about 15 kilometers, which is why the whole atmosphere should heat up, because you need this gradient to push the heat out. So this is what you would expect as a function of latitude and altitude for the heating from models with well-mixed greenhouse gases. On the other hand, you find that the actual heating as measured with radiosondes is inconsistent with what you would predict. Here, this is another way of seeing it. You have here the prediction, predicted heating by different, or the range obtained by different models which the IPCC quotes. And here is the range of observations with radiosonde data.
Sorry, rate on the bottom?
And that's height. That's pressure and this is height, but it's the same thing. So just to recast it in other words, this is the range of climate sensitivities as quoted in different models, in different IPCC reports, the first one and the last one.
And what climate sensitivity is?
It's the full derivative. It's the full derivative of the temperature with respect to the energy budget, the radiative forcing. If we double the amount of CO2 and we change the energy budget by 3.8 watts per square meter, by how much the temperature will increase? Now, if you open all the IPCC reports, they'll tell you that it's between 1.5 and 4.5 degrees. And it all dates back to the Charney Committee, which was established in 1979.
What's the relation between that and the question of the cause, whether it's CO2 or...
Okay, so the standard... let me jump a bit. Okay, this is how it's related. In the standard picture, we have observed some temperature change over the 20th century. Now, we know what is the, or we have an estimate for what is the radiative forcing associated with human activity. In order to explain this temperature change, we need the change in the anthropogenic forcing. For a given change in the anthropogenic forcing, we need a high climate sensitivity. Basically, the change in the forcing times the sensitivity will give you the temperature change. Of course, this is very simplified because the climate system has it's a low pass filter and you have to do all the integrations. But this is a very schematic way to show you why the cause of the forcing is important. If, on the other hand, you have an additional positive forcing, which is that of the sun, then it means that over the 20th century, we had a larger net change in the climate, in the radiative forcing. And therefore, in order to explain the same change in the temperature, we now need a low climate sensitivity. This low climate sensitivity will now imply that the same given emission scenario over the 21st century will give you a lower temperature increase, which is why our model for the global climate that includes the sun gives us at the best fit, with the best fit, we get a lower temperature increase for the 21st century.
Can I replace anthropogenic forcing by CO2?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean,
well,
independent of...
Yes, but some people...
could just put CO2.
Yes, but it's more complicated because there are other gases and there are aerosols, which are not understood very well.
Greenhouse gases.
So. Yeah. No, it's exactly the same sensitivity.
I don't think that's what I read in your paper. I mean, you have a different variation of solar constant as forcing, or you use an...
No, I use the solar constant as a proxy for what the sun is doing. Okay? When I do this model, that is very briefly described here, or the results of which are described here, let's suppose we don't know what the solar force is, and assume that it's related to the solar constant, because that's a proxy of solar activity. Then I can later ask the question, when I find the fit, what is the contribution of the solar forcing over the 20th century? And when I do that, I find that it's about 1 watt per square meter. So it's an independent way to assess the forcing of the sun. And lo and behold, it's exactly what you get, or not exactly, it's consistently what you get from the variations when you use the ocean as a calorimeter. So it's.
But that's 10 times the value of the solar constant.
Where were you the last half hour? My main point was that the solar constant is irrelevant. It's irrelevant. The solar constant is irrelevant because the sun has a much larger effect on the climate, and you can see that in the oceans.
But you haven't shown, you say it's the cloud, but you haven't shown...
What? I haven't shown what?
I mean, you have a forcing of 1 watt per meter squared that's coming out of nowhere. I mean,
no, it's not coming out of nowhere. I see that in going into and out of the oceans when I look at the solar cycle, okay? Now, the variations in solar activity over the 20th century are comparable to the variations, like the average in solar activity is comparable to the change between solar minimum and solar maximum. So if I see a change of about 1 watt per square meter over the solar cycle, I should expect to see 1 watt per square meter also on the 20th century. And when I do a fit like this, and I ask the question, what is the best forcing that the sun has had over the 20th century, I find, by coincidence or not, that the sun should have contributed about 1 watt per square meter. Now, you don't have to believe any single word I said about cosmic rays and climate. The fact is, you see that over the solar cycle, a large amount of heat goes into the ocean, but all the standard global circulation models don't take that into account. But
let him wind up. But I think what he's worrying about is this amplification point, which is exactly the link he was trying to get at in the lab studies. But would you prefer to end? Or I am a little worried.
Okay, so let me say just one or two words. The slides I skipped are all empirical evidence that the climate has a small sensitivity to CO2. Just one example. Here you see variations in the temperature reconstruction over the past 500 million years at the bottom. And at the top, you see a reconstruction in the CO2. Mind you, this is a logarithmic scale. So you have variations over geological time scales. You have variations which are a factor of 10 in the CO2. And these variations in the CO2 don't translate into changes in the temperature. And with that, you can place an upper limit on the sensitivity to CO2 to 1.5 degree increase per CO2 doubling. And there are other half a dozen different timescales that you can show that the sensitivity to the climate sensitivity is on the low side, not on the high side. But I won't get into them. So let me just wrap up. This basically sums up my main point. If you try to explain the 20th century and without the real effect that the sun should have on the climate, you need a high climate sensitivity to explain the 20th century, and the high climate sensitivity predicts a large climate change over the 21st century. If you have an additional source of forcing, the best fit will be one with a lower climate sensitivity and therefore a lower temperature increase over the 21st century. And with this, I'll end. You can read the points, and I think this relates to the previous discussion that we had here before. What do you mean, what about them?
So you said, what about data from ice core that goes through in an intermediate range of time? Like
okay. So let's ask our friend Al Gore. He had... here. This is Al Gore. From his movie. He showed us this graph in the movie. What you see in this graph, at the bottom, it's a reconstruction of the CO2 from ice cores. And at the top, you see a reconstruction of the temperature based either on oxygen or deuterium.
So this time scale is?
And the time scale is... It's 100,000, 600,000. So it's an ice core from Antarctica. And then he shows us that there is this correlation between the two things, and he says, the relation is complicated, but you see that when there is more CO2, the temperature is higher. This is exactly what he said in the movie. Now, he wants to lead you to the idea that CO2 variations necessarily cause large variations in the temperature. But who said it's not vice versa, that the temperature affects the CO2? Now, it turns out that in all ice cores, when you have a high enough resolution, then either you don't have the resolution to see it, but if you have the resolution, it's generally the CO2 which is lagging after the temperature change. So the CO2 has some effect on the temperature, but the ice cores don't tell you anything about what this relation is.
So that is an accident.
No, it's not an accident. It tells you a lot about the equilibrium between CO2, which is in the atmosphere, and CO2, which is in the oceans. You have, in the oceans, you have 50 times as much CO2 as carbonic acid, and there's an equilibrium between the CO2 in the atmosphere and the CO2 in the oceans, and this equilibrium depends on the temperature. If you hit the oceans, and it takes you several hundred years to hit the oceans, you change this equilibrium, and then the CO2 is released, and this is exactly what you see here. Of course, some of it is amplification of the temperature because of the change of the CO2, but you don't know what it is because of the problem of causality. So the way to see whether CO2 has a large effect on climate or not is to look at CO2 variations which are not due to temperature variations. And that's CO2 variations on geological timescales, because on geological timescales, it's CO2 which is emitted by volcanic activity on one hand, and CO2 which settles down as limestone on the oceans and then goes for recycling whatever it's called.
Subduction.
Yeah, subduction zones. And then you have large variations in the CO2 which don't appear to translate into large changes in the temperature. So you can place an upper limit on the effects of the CO2.
Any hands?
So this isn't a scientific question, but so my dad has no idea about any scientific breakthroughs that has happened in the last 50 years, yet he knows all about your like sunspot and cosmic ray stuff because he works for a coal and natural gas company, and he gets memos all the time from people on the top, and then he forwards them to me because I'm just like scientist stuff. And in the student hour, you seem, you know, very willing to admit that there could be very anthropogenically sourced things that are negative, that are happening in the environment. And I'm wondering, are you worried that some of your research is being, you know, misappropriated by people with ulterior motives? And if so, what social responsibility do you feel to make sure that it doesn't happen?
I'm a scientist, and it's my obligation to do the science as honestly as I can. I won't change my scientific opinion just because some oil guy thinks he can use it for his benefit, or because an environmentalist can use it for his benefit. I mean, I'm trying to do the science as good as I can, and then let the society, you know, choose whatever it wants to do and best use it, you know, as wisely as they can. Now, if humanity realizes that, you know, a 2 degree increase in the temperature over the 21st century is not that bad, maybe we can use these resources to fight other things like, you know, malaria or Ebola or, you know, whatever we'll have. On the other hand, maybe that the CO2 is bad because a 2 degree increase is very bad, and it could be that the ocean acidification because of the CO2 is also bad. I don't know. My role as an honest scientist is just to do the science as good as I can, and I'm not going to change the way the science I do just because people can misuse it or use it, you know, for their own goals.
Yeah.
Is it correct to say though that your predictions for the increase in temperature, which looks pretty sudden in the last, I don't know, 50 years and continuing, is anthropogenic? It's just less than you would estimate if you neglected the effect of solar.
Well, first of all, the warming over the last 50 years is not unique, because the warming between 1970 and 2000 is exactly the same in terms of length and temperature derivative as the warming between 1910 and 1940. So it's not unique, and you know, there were periods in Earth history that we had warmer temperature, or significantly warmer temperature. So I don't agree that it's very strange.
No,
I do agree, but I do agree that part of the warming over the last the latter half of the 20th century is anthropogenic.
And no, but what you're predicting for the 21st century
is mostly anthropogenic.
Show.
It is anthropogenic.
And it's worrisome, but not as worrisome as the conventional wisdom says. Is that a roughly correct summary?
Yes. The thing is that I don't know how worrisome it should be. If I would have, suppose we would have lived in the year 1900, and I would have told you, Pierre, right? Look, over the 20th century, the temperature is going to rise by 0.8 degrees. Maybe we can do something against it. Would you do it? Are the conditions today so much worse than they are in terms of climate than they were in the year 1900? I don't know. And on the same token, I don't know whether this increase...
According, forget about IPCC. I'm just looking at your thing.
Okay.
It's 1 or 2 degrees.
I don't know. You know, the IPCC met in Copenhagen a few years ago, they said we need to make sure that the temperature increase over the 21st century is going to be less than 2 degrees.
Right.
Okay. Another thing. This assumes a business as usual scenario. I'm optimistic, and I don't think we're going to burn fossil fuels in 50 years, because I look at the price of photovoltaic cells, and I see that it's decreasing exponentially. The price of oil is all the time increasing, because the cost of producing every barrel of oil is getting progressively more expensive. So at some point, it is going to be cheaper, and we're all going to switch to alternative energy sources just because we want
because
to save money.
Because this is anthropogenic, according to you. It's just not as much as...
Yes.
That's correct.
Yes, but we are going to switch to alternative energy sources just because we want to save money, not because...
That isn't the science. I mean, he's asking questions about the science, and you're answering with...
I already answered it. I said, yeah, this is this warming is anthropogenic.
Yeah, so let's be clear about the answer.
What?
For this question, full stop, that is the answer.
Yes, but then he's...
That's the answer.
No.
Scientific question.
But there was a second part of the question, and that is, should it be worrisome?
No,
I don't know. No, but you mentioned worrisome, right? You said worrisome, so I had to address it.
You want to be an honest scientist, and you don't want to say what the political consensus is.
Yes. Pierre said worrisome, so I said, I don't know whether it's worrisome or not, because I don't know how to judge a 2 degree increase or a 1 degree increase.
Well, I don't know how to judge how much we're going to be using solar power versus nuclear power.
Okay, so I just said that I am personally not worried.
I really don't think we should be talking about what people meant to say.
Okay. Yes.
Not too much discussion how you compute that global average, what the error bars are. Nevertheless, you say there's a correlation, and this based on this, you claim that this is a very important strong correlation, right?
Yes.
So, and
11 sigma.
You're kind of independent of that. You have your argument that the cosmic rays increase nucleation sites and increase cloudiness, and so that allows you in your climate and your GCM, which you don't explain the details of, to tweak the parameter in such a way that you just sort of increase the rate at which clouds are produced.
No, not exactly. My main point...
Consistent with your inverse...
No, it's not exact, because what I'm saying is that you don't need to know the exact mechanism. You don't need to know that the effect is through cosmic rays or through something else, because you see that the sun has a large effect on climate, and therefore you have to take it into account.
Okay, wait, but first of all, then you're making it... I'm sort of surprised coming here, because I sort of expected you
you start with a very clear mechanistic-based argument for what you're going to say. You started by showing a lot of correlations for quantities, but I'm sure no one in here has, including me, has any idea the amount of complexity that goes into, you know, correlating delta O.
Which is why you should now go and read the papers.
Some of us have, at least. Olivia has done more due diligence than me. But regardless, you're right, we should, of course. But of course, you should also, you know, I would think, and especially with an audience that's not well-versed in all of this, start by a simple mechanism and then compare this to all the other suggested mechanisms that are in all these zillion other papers that have talked about, you know, simple mechanisms. For example, carbon dioxide and the water vapor feedback, that's a really simple mechanism that I hope everybody in here.
But that gives you a very large climate sensitivity, so which is inconsistent with the data.
Is a little
what?
Less, right?
I said you should answer.
So the only point is, all you're really saying is that this correlation between this measurement, so-called measure of globally average sea surface height in the sun cycle, indicates to you that the overall sensitivity is less. And therefore, you're not making a mechanism, you're just making a kind of correlation.
What I'm saying, the main takeaway point for climate people is that you shouldn't care. The main argument, if you open the IPCC report, they say we don't understand the cosmic ray climate mechanism and probably it's small, so therefore we're not really considering it in the models. That's what appears in the IPCC report. What I'm saying is that the empirical evidence is such that the sun has a large effect on climate. You can quantify it and you can see that it's about 1 watt per square meter. You have to take it into account when you're modeling the 20th century or any other time scale, but it's not. And if you do that, you find that if you would try to fit the 20th century, you will get that it is consistent with a low climate sensitivity. And I can show you in other ways that the climate sensitivity should be on the low side. Like if you average the climate response following the 6 largest volcanic eruptions since Krakatoa, you see that the numerical models give you that the decrease should have been between 0.3 and 0.5 degrees. But in reality, the average decrease in the temperature was 0.1 degree, which is much smaller. Another is the geological timescales that shows you that CO2 doesn't have a large effect on climate. And so forth. There are other examples like that. So the climate sensitivity I get empirically is on the low side. This is consistent with the fact that the sun has a large effect on climate. But again, you should reach your own conclusion, but you have to run climate models that take the sun into account. If you don't take the sun into account, you reach the wrong conclusions.
Well, let's say professional questions over the professionals that have other questions.
So on the topic of your mechanisms, I don't recall you presenting any evidence that once you end up with these larger aerosol aggregates, that they in fact do promote nucleation of water droplets beyond the...
Okay, so this is...
The pictures of the clouds left behind jetliners. And my understanding is that there has been interest in this as a commercial technology, even cloud seeding, and that this has been somewhat of a failure, and that cloud seeding technology doesn't work.
You have several questions in your question. Where is that graph? I lost it.
I think I have one question. I'm just asking. Am I mistaken that...
I didn't show you, but we can take the changes in the number density that we think takes place with the cosmic ray flux, put it in a global aerosol model, and get variations which could explain the cloud cover variation that we see empirically with a solar cycle. You had a question about cloud seeding. Well, most of the cloud seeding you're talking about is already the formation of raindrops from formed clouds. So this is something else that people do with, silver iodide and things like that. So this is already, that's already a different question. There are, incidentally, drawer plans in case, you know, we need to cool the planet. People have thought about, for example, adding pods to each commercial flight that distributed aerosols, and you change the cloud properties and you will cool the Earth this way. Of course, people are afraid of such solutions because they are very drastic and you don't know whether you're going to cause another problem, a bigger one.